Now that gifting is where you need to get specific.
That was not unusual during our marketing conversations to say, well, what's our top drug writer? You know, who's the doctor that's prescribing the most of this drug? Well, you know, let's send them to the Kentucky Derby.
We offered trips on some occasions to come out and hear a two-hour talk, but it happened to be on a nice island in Hawaii.
There were a lot of things that we did day in and day out to try to get the doctors to write our drugs, or in my case, to write for the psychiatric drugs. We did a lot of lunches and dinners, and we brought in speakers, and those speakers were obviously paid by us, and we would wave, you know, renowned studies at them from renowned journals. But of course, we would never say that these studies were paid for by our company, and that it was written by a ghostwriter who was paid by our company, or that our company tends to do a ton of advertising within that particular medical journal. We would never say that.
With over 300 million psychiatric drug prescriptions written every year, high prescribing psychiatrists are richly rewarded for opening up new markets. They receive up to 25% more pharmaceutical money than any other medical specialty. An average in one state of more than $45,000 per top psychiatrist per year.
Psychiatrists get more kickback from the pharmaceutical companies than any other branch of medicine.
The profession of psychiatry couldn't keep its journals afloat, couldn't keep its conferences afloat, couldn't keep its organizations afloat without money from drug companies. The drug companies really have psychiatry in their pocket.
This is a profession whose diagnoses have been heavily influenced by people who are heavily influenced by the pharmaceutical industry, and whose treatments are almost exclusively these days pharmaceuticals. We should be able to count on them. I do not believe that we can.
Due to the ceaseless promotion by psychiatrists, psychotropic drug prescription has permeated not just psychiatry, but the entire medical profession. But this promotional campaign has a second prong that lines the pockets of psychiatrists more than any other. And this one directly targets you.
Abilify helps control symptoms of bipolar mania.
Ask your doctor about Effexor XR.
Paxil, the most prescribed medication of its kind.
Prozac Weekly is here.
Zoloft, a prescription.
Seraphim.
PMDD.
Psychiatrists and drug companies don't hype psychiatric drugs only to fellow prescribers. They also pitch them straight to the end user, you, counting on you to walk into their offices and demand a prescription.
The direct-to-consumer advertising is instilling the notion in every human being that something is mentally wrong, something needs correction. That drives people to see a psychiatrist to help to mitigate this by dispensing the medication, by dispensing a drug that they have had pushed on them on countless television ads, countless magazine ads, and countless print ads that say, hey, there's something wrong with you. Go get help for it.
Nowhere is this explosion of direct-to-consumer advertising more obvious than on television. It wasn't always this way. Until recently, advertising psychiatric drugs on TV was severely restricted. But in 1997, the FDA was persuaded to relax their rules on advertising in the media, in direct violation of Article 10 of an international treaty signed at the United Nations.
Every 5 minutes there's a new drug ad. And this is not by accident, this is cold, canny, scientific design.
Ads are fundamentally of two types. One type of ad is a effort to try to get the patient to take the drug company's drug.
Abilify helps control symptoms of bipolar mania.
But then the second kind of direct-to-consumer advertising is the you're sick and you didn't know it advertising.
You could be suffering from generalized anxiety disorder.
Because they want to create sales, so what they're going to do is tell people, do you have these symptoms? Do you have this disease? Do you have this particular condition?
But they hit it so hard on television that people say, ask your doctor, ask your doctor. Every commercial is a referral to the doctor. See, they're working for each other.
Ask your doctor about Cymbalta. Depression hurts. Cymbalta can help.
I can go to my doctor and say, here are my symptoms, and
walk out with the prescription I want. I can ask for a drug by name, and most of the time I'll be given the drug. So basically I'm my own doctor.
The industry defends what it's doing by saying this is some kind of public health education campaign. And I'm sorry, I think if you go to an advertising agency, you're advertising.
From the start, advertising psychiatric drugs on television has been phenomenally successful. In just the first 3 years, sales of psychiatric drugs skyrocketed by 250%. With grosses now hitting record levels, the drug industry is spending $2.9 billion a year in TV advertising alone. And once this drives people into the offices of psychiatrists, they can be hooked using another marketing ploy, free samples.
The industry is willing to give out millions of dollars worth of free samples because it generates billions of dollars in sales.
You want a prescription and you want Prozac written forever as a maintenance therapy. So you establish that with some free Prozac up front.
Here, take this sample. It doesn't cost you anything. And then if you like it or if it seems to work, then we'll make a prescription. But you're going to have to pay for that prescription. The sample is free. So it's really a marketing technique.
They got a cash cow. Zero refill means you've got to go back to the doctor for another consultation, for another subscription, and it just goes forever. This is business. This is money.
Some direct-to-consumer marketing is camouflaged as public information. Psychiatrists regularly appear in the media, warning the public of the latest mental illness epidemics and hawking their latest breakthroughs. They write articles planted in newspapers and magazines that further their mental health awareness campaigns. Even patient advocacy groups claiming to offer unbiased information on psychiatric drugs are, upon closer inspection, pharmaceutically funded front groups managed by psychiatrists.
They were started specifically by the industry themselves, and the public isn't informed of that. You know, it's basically a great big lie to the public that they think they're going to a charitable organization that has their best interest at heart.
Case in point, children and adults with attention deficit disorder, or CHAD, the biggest and most well-funded front group for the makers of stimulant drugs. Stephen Plogg is a former CHAD executive.
When I became the CHAD coordinator for Las Vegas, they gave me a manual, and in it it said, we want to provide unbiased information to help and support people who have ADD. For the next 30 days, we put 22 parents and their kids on a program with lab tests to find out what their causes were, eliminated their causes, they got prescription-free, medication-free, side-effect-free, and they got better with their self-esteem, and they became actually happier, healthier, and more successful. Chad found out about this, called me up and says, we do not allow people to talk about nutrition in any of our seminars. We only prescribe going to a psychiatrist who will only prescribe drugs and therapy. So they said, you can no longer work with us, and they fired me for simply recommending that parents go get a lab test, find out what the causes are, and eliminate the causes. They do not allow that. They only allow medication and psychiatric treatment.
Psychiatric patient advocacy groups also promote psychotropic drug treatment by broadly issuing public marketing surveys disguised as medical questionnaires.
You can take a survey of maybe 16 questions. And if you are a normal human being who's lived through ranges of emotions of normal life experience, if you've known the exhilaration of the birth of a child, a niece, a nephew, and the devastation of a divorce and the loss of dreams, and answer honestly to those questions, you will diagnose yourself as bipolar. And the instructions that come back along with the diagnosis or the warning that you're probably bipolar say, print this out and take it to your doctor.
And how simple is it for anyone to go online, answer typical life questions, and be given a psychiatric disorder? Here are some randomly chosen volunteers, people of all ages leading normal lives.
Do you feel sad, blue, unhappy, or down in the dumps? Sometimes.
I've had periods of great optimism and other periods of equally great pessimism. Yeah, that happens a little bit.
I get tired for no reason. Sometimes.
Life is pretty full.
Not really.
For no apparent reason, I sometimes have been very angry or hostile.
It's hard for me to concentrate on reading.
I am restless and can't keep still.
My heart beats faster than usual.
I have trouble sleeping.
Shortness of breath.
Gained weight.
Trembling hands.
I have an idea that most of these are going to be sometimes.